I'm Stephen Metcalf, and this is the Slate Culture Gabfest American Fiction Oscar Contender Edition. It's Wednesday, January 31st, 2024. On today's show, we kick off Oscar season when we make sure we cover every major nominee in the run-up to the awards ceremony. We start with American Fiction. It comes to us via writer-director Cord Jefferson. It's been heavily marketed as a satire about race in the book publishing industry. But it's also, as one discovers in the theater, a heartfelt family dramedy. It stars Jeffrey Wright, and it's been nominated for 5 Oscars, including Best Actor and Picture. And then Mike Judge, he of Beavis and Butthead and Silicon Valley fame, returns with a stop-motion animated comedy, In the Know. It skewers a hopelessly narcissistic NPR host, voiced by Zach Woods, and you can find it on Peacock. And finally, you know, there are Oscar snubs, and then there are Oscar snubs. No Greta, no Margot, no Leo. We discuss some glaring omissions from the nominee list. But first, joining me today is Sam Sanders, the esteemed NPR vet and host of the podcast Vibe Check, which drops every Wednesday. Sam, welcome to the show.
It's so good to be here. I have been a fan for a very long time, and I'm excited to be chatting with y'all this episode.
Well, we'd love to hear that there are longtime fans out there, and that you're one of them is extra special. So it's awesome and very kind of you to step in. And of course, Nadira Goffe is also esteemed, and she's the Slate culture writer and exceedingly old, ancient even friend of this program. That's a something fop. Nadira, as always, just a delight to have you on the show.
Thanks for having me. It's always so fun to be here.
All right, let's dig in. Monk Ellison is a novelist and a professor whose interests and talents we're led to believe are hopelessly non-commercial. Apparently, he likes writing novels based on Greek tragedies. When a series of major life upheavals places him in financial straits, he contemplates being something he's resisted thus far, a self-consciously black writer as opposed to simply a writer who happens to be black. What follows is a gutting satire of the American publishing industry as it tries to square its bad conscience with its desire to move new product. Combined with a deeply felt family comedy drama, the film is based on the novel Erasure by Percival Everett, and it's the directorial debut from Cord Jefferson, who also wrote the screenplay. Okay, in the clip we're going to hear, you'll hear Jeffrey Wright as Ellison. He's at a chain bookstore, and he realizes that his novels have been placed in the African-American studies section instead of the regular fiction section. Here he is complaining to the store employee. Let's have a listen.
Wait a minute. Why are these books here?
I'm not sure. I would imagine that this author, Ellison, is black.
That's me. Ellison.
Yeah.
He is me, and he and I are black.
Oh, bingo.
No bingo, Ned. These books have nothing to do with African-American studies. They're just literature. The blackest thing about this one is the ink.
I don't decide what sections the books go in, and no one here does. That's how chain stores work.
Right. Ned, you don't make the rules.
All right. That bingo is a great line reading. Nadira, let's start with you. I said this a couple times because it really struck me how the trailer for the film made it seem like a straight-up satire. It's something quite different on actually viewing it. What do you make of this film?
Yeah, this film is, as you were saying, sort of, in my opinion, two films in one. And the part I liked more than the very funny, and I do want to say it is very funny, satirical meditation on black representation in the publishing world and art writ large, is actually the family drama and the depiction of a failure to generate some generational wealth amongst a black family, and this sort of really interesting dynamic between the siblings when it comes to taking care of ailing parents and keeping the family together. And I found that to be more interesting than the satire that everyone, you know, is mostly focusing on. I really want to talk about Tracy Ellis Ross, whom I love, who plays Lisa, Monk's younger sister, in this movie. And Lisa is a doctor who has stayed behind to take care of their ailing mother. And the siblings, there's Monk, Lisa, and then also a third sibling named Cliff, played by Sterling K. Brown, who's amazing as well in the film. But yeah, so Lisa, she's a Black woman, and I believe that she's younger than Monk. And as a Black woman who is the oldest of three siblings, I have personally had these conversations with people about some of the responsibility in taking care of older relatives when they begin to need care. And there's a sort of ever-flexible line between whether or not you're forced to take the role because you're the eldest, or whether or not you're forced to take the role because you're the most financially available, or whether or not you're forced to take the role because you're the woman of the siblings. And I think that Tracy Ellis Ross, who has been in the industry for so long and is so talented, finally gets a role where she can balance some really nuanced expectations. And, you know, she balances not only the expectations, but the worry she has for her brothers, and also the resentment of whatever answers to those questions that I said were that she feels laid in her, while her brothers can sort of carry on totally unaware of what she's sustaining and dealing with. And she's in the movie for a relatively short period of time compared to other characters, but I feel like her impact in that movie is so strong, and I don't think that enough people are paying attention to that specific part of it. And so, yeah, I think that's really where I want to start. I don't necessarily want to start with the novel or Monk or Jeffrey Wright. I want to start with Tracy Ellis Ross, because it seems like that's such a foundational part of the movie to me.
Oh, here. I'm in the little notes I have for my comment. I was going to start with her, funnily enough, because I totally agree. She's foundational to the family story, which is in some ways totally central to the movie. She's a very grounding, very funny presence.
Books change people's lives.
Has something I've written ever changed your life?
Absolutely. Absolutely. My dining room table was wobbly as hell.
Oh my God.
Before your last book came out, it was like perfect.
But Sam, let's turn to you before I start to babble. Maybe start there about the mix between this satire and this family drama. What did you make of the balance of that?
I think he did what he had to do. So I've talked with Cord Jefferson, who wrote the film and directed the film, on Vibe Check. We chatted for over an hour. It's in that podcast feed now. And I should disclose here that Cord and I are friends. When I was back in D.C. covering breaking news and politics, and when Cord was in D.C. as a journalist, we were in the same drinking circles. And we hung out a lot many, many years ago. We've hung out a lot less since we've both been here in Los Angeles. But I call Cord a friend, and I've known him for over a decade now. And so I realized, the more that I've watched this film and talked to him, had he just made a straight-ahead Black family drama, none of us would talk about it.
Yeah.
When is the last time a straight-ahead Black family drama got five Oscar nominations and as much buzz as American Fiction got? Cord made the trailer he had to make to get our attention, and he drew us in with that, and then gave us, like, two films in one. So I'm like, good for you, sir. Like, kudos to you. You did something that is, like, actually really hard to do. I think that my biggest takeaway from this film is that it has to do the exact same work that it is critiquing in the film. Cord Jefferson is functioning in his career right now as the character of Monk has had to function in his career. Am I making things that are Black? Am I making things that are white? I want to make things that speak to me, but I need white gatekeepers to like what I make. And you're watching this dynamic play out with him making this movie. So I think that's really captivating. I do think if I'm comparing the family drama half of the movie to the racial publishing satire of the movie, I like them both, but I like the family drama better.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think Tracy Ellis Ross is a movie star. And I told Cor this when we chatted. I think that wedding scene, and this is not a spoiler, that wedding scene towards the end of the film is just truly magnificent and brings happy tears to your eyes. And it's one of the best music posts in a film that I've heard in years. The song that they play while they're all dancing.
Oh, yeah.
We'll do the things together only lovers do. Let love flow on, baby.
It's called Let Love Flow On by Sonia Spence. I've been playing that song nonstop since the film was released.
Me too.
I think this movie is subversively brilliant because Cord does a bait and switch and still gives you a good film.
Yeah, I'm with both of you, I think. I came at it from a different angle, which is that satire is so flattening. It's a flattening genre or art. You know, you have to turn real human beings into caricatures, which sends them in the direction of being two-dimensional. But this movie is about a man who's quintessentially not a caricature and then makes himself into one. So in a way, you sort of need both films so that you have this, I think, very funny but ultimately somewhat broadly drawn satiric portion, which on a percentage basis may be 20% of the film. I mean, it's a surprisingly small amount of it, juxtaposed with this completely realistic, in some ways very wrenching, multi-generational family drama that's in the utterly unsatiric mode, right? And it involves, without, you know, hope without spoiling it, like serious illness, serious, like grievous loss, deep family secrets, and bitter sibling rivalry. And I also want to shout out, in addition to Tracy Ellis Ross, Sterling Brown as Monk's brother. I thought that was an incredible performance.
Oscar nominated now. It was phenomenal. I've had some conversations with like other gays in my circles, and they're like, is this stereotypical? And I'm like, I don't care. I like it.
That's interesting.
It's fun. He's delivering.
And Sammy's fucking angry. That character is really, really dark, bitter, funny.
I think what I actually love is that they're all angry. They are angry.
Yes.
They just show it in really different ways. And that's something that it took a few days for me to actually realize or figure out. And I think what I actually love about Monk, not to cut you off, Steve, I'll let you get back to your point,
but
I really just want to say something that I love about Monk is that not only does he stay unapologetic to seeing his hoax through, but I kind of sort of hate that guy.
Yeah.
He's arrogant in the specific way that he could.
And he's
let...
mean to his girlfriend.
Yes,
he is mean to his girlfriend.
He's mean to Erica Alexander, and I don't like that.
And who does that?
who would? Not me. No one should. But he's arrogant in the specific way that he could let a bull loose in a china shop and be surprised to walk in and find everything smashed to bits, and then have the nerve to blame anyone who might actually think there's something salvageable in it. But Jeffrey Wright is incredible at being that really arrogant, annoying guy who's mean to his girlfriend, but still really captivating.
Mm-hmm.
I think the way he shows anger as a juxtaposition to the way his siblings show anger is really fascinating and a part of what makes both sides actually work for me, but obviously makes the family drama side work more.
Yeah, you get these portraits of people who are sitting on enormous reservoirs of pain and resentment vis-a-vis one another and anger, and then you get a little backstory glance here, a little backstory glance there, and you see why. And that, to me, given the three performances of the siblings, that was enormously powerful to suddenly see why he's so tightened and his brother is so, you know, sharply cut.
Can we talk about the ending? I'm intrigued by how he finished this film. And I think it was a beautiful middle finger to expectations, but I wonder what y'all's take on it is. So for me, long story short, this trailer for American Fiction that sets up this racial satire about the publishing industry, it primes you to expect at some point in the film, Jeffrey Wright's character, the black male lead, Monk, you expect him to have some moment where he has a I'm not going to take it anymore yell fest. You expect a soliloquy, a monologue in which he tells the good white liberals that they're actually bad, and he yells, and then your fist raises and huh! That never happens. That never happens in this movie. And at first I was like, am I mad about that? Did I not get the catharsis I wanted in this film because Jeffrey Wright didn't have his monologue at the end? And then I was like, you know what? This entire movie, I think, is about fooling and disappointing good white liberals and good black liberals' expectations. This is a movie that makes you think it's going one way and then it goes another. So, of course, it's going to give you an ending that is good but kind of a head-scratcher. And I like that.
Can I be a point of contention? Can I be a fly in the ointment?
Yeah, because I feel this way about the film today, but next week it might change. Of all the films this Oscar season, I've gone the most up and down with this one.
Same. I completely agree. And here's the thing about this movie, and I think this is also my sort of issue with the ending, which isn't actually an issue with the ending, but just is a sort of exasperation with the movie, which is that I'm sort of tired of this belabored question amongst Black creatives that is pondering the acceptance from majority white audiences or white powers that be in their industries about the best, most financially successful ways to kowtow to white audiences. And in that way, I do think the film sort of still feels dated to 2001, which is when the book that
the book came out.
Off of.
Yeah.
Right, yeah. And I think the tension specifically between Monk and Issa Rae's character, to me, is maybe the biggest signifier of that. But Aisha
and that's
Harris,
never resolved, which I found quite interesting.
Yes, yeah. I agree with that, too. I actually like that was never resolved. But Aisha Harris mentioned this in her NPR review, and I found myself wondering this while watching as well, which is, in a movie that is supposedly set in today, where is the concern about Black Twitter? Where are the collegiate discussions of the book amongst Black groups on campuses? What are the conversations about how Black people feel about the works that are quote-unquote Black experiences written for white consumption? Where are they in the film?
Well, yeah.
Yeah, and I think when it got to the end, it wasn't necessarily that I was disappointed with the ending, which, I don't know, I also go back and forth on. Some days I like it, some days I don't. But it was more like, why are we ending it now? There's so much more interesting stuff that I wanted into.
Yeah, I do think, you know, you allude to this question, like, what would Black Twitter think of this book? I think based on the source material, the conversation around race in the book and the film happens before Black Twitter exists, right?
Right.
And I think that had the central question of Black acceptance of Black art or whatever, had that question been originally written in a book by Percival Everett in 2023 or 4, it would have been different. I also think that this question will increasingly become obsolete as the monoculture continues to die and everyone is just finding their micro communities anyway. You know, like,
perhaps
the next great
that
Black author might just, it makes me feel better. Like, I long for a day when we don't have, like, the Black film of the year or the gay film of the year. I long for the day when fans of things can build micro communities strong enough and big enough to support that stuff away from the gaze of the majority.
Right. So
I really long for that day.
So micro communities that still have power to actually make stuff. That's my...
Yes.
Right, right. Okay,
yes.
Cool. Yeah, we're good
And, like, I think that is the future. And I think had Monk been a writer who had started writing in the age of internet and social media, he might have found his micro community of nerds who like Black guys writing nerd shit. And he might have been happy.
Yeah.
He might have been happy,
very
right?
Very true, very true.
But the central questions of this movie are still grappling with monoculture.
Yeah.
And that is a conversation that I don't think we're going to be having in 10 years. So it's good Cord made this movie now, not 10 years from now.
Right.
I love it. All right. Well, I like it when we can end a segment with a quasi-utopian note. So we'll curtail it there. All right. The movie is American Fiction. It's out in theaters now. It's been heavily nominated. Jeffrey Wright's wonderful in it. Multiple great ensemble cast performances. Check it out.
This episode is brought to you by SAP. First, the bad news. SAP Business AI won't help you generate cubist versions of your family's holiday photos, but it will help you understand which supplier is best to help you roll out your plant-based packaging in Southeast Asia, identify the training your junior project manager needs to rise up the ranks, and automate repetitive tasks while you focus on big innovations so you can be ready for the next opportunity. Revolutionary technology, real-world results. That's SAP Business AI.
Reboot your credit card with Apple Card. It gives you unlimited daily cash back that can automatically grow over time when you open a savings account. A high-yield, low-effort way to grow your money with no fees. Apply for Apple Card in the Wallet app on iPhone to start earning daily cash and growing it with savings today. Apple Card subject to credit approval. Savings available to Apple Card owners subject to eligibility. Apple Card and Savings by Goldman Sachs Bank USA, Salt Lake City Branch. Member FDIC. Terms apply.
Steve, I think you're probably with me on this. I know when I have money that I've earned in one of these rewards programs, my favorite thing to spend it on is travel. And I know you're a huge travel guy. Do you have any big trips on the calendar for this year or some dream destination you've been wanting to visit?
Okay, it's funny that you should ask that, but I've been laboring over an essay about George Orwell and the conditions under which he wrote his iconic novel, 1984, which he wrote on this Scottish island in the Inner Hebrides called Jura. And I'm dying to go there now that I've read extensively about Orwell's life there. I mean, he set up a homestead. He loved it. He built hen houses and fished for lobsters and seafood. And it was living that way that he wrote, you know, arguably one of the most important masterpieces of 20th century fiction, at least in English.
It's so amazing that the great dystopian novel of the 20th century was written in utopia, it sounds like.
You nailed it, because that's exactly the kind of antithesis, really, that I'm setting up in the essay. Anyway, exploring that relationship in his own sort of creative mind and processes has been a real journey.
Wow. I really hope you get to go there, and I can't wait to read this essay.
All right. Now is the moment in our podcast when we discuss business. We have just one item this week. That's to tell listeners about today's Slate Plus segment. This week, we're going to discuss an interactive piece in the New York Times called The Menu Trends That Define Dining Right Now. The folks at the Times collected 121 menus from across the United States, tried to recognize some patterns. We'll discuss some of their findings and talk about menu trends that we like and dislike. If you're a Slate Plus member, make sure to stick around for that conversation at the end of the show. If you're not a Slate Plus member, I have some words for you. You can sign up today at slate.com/culture plus. Members get ad-free podcasts and lots of bonus content like the Slate Plus segment, better known as the Slat Plus segment that I just mentioned. You'll also get to hear members-only programming on other Slate shows like Slow Burn and the Political Gabfest. Members get unlimited access to all the great writing on Slate.com. You'll never hit a paywall if you're a Slate Plus member. I should also mention that you'll be supporting our work and the work of our brilliant colleagues. These memberships are really, really important to Slate. I can't emphasize that enough. Now I'm being serious. It makes a huge difference to us if you sign up. So please do it today at slate.com/culture plus. Again, that's slate.com/culture plus. All right, on with the show. Okay, well, sitcom auteur Mike Judge has given us such shows as Beavis and Butthead, King of the Hill, Silicon Valley. He returns now to Peacock, the streaming service Peacock, with the show In the Know. It's an animated stop-motion workplace sitcom centered on a character named Lauren Caspian. He is host of NPR's third most popular show. He is self-centered, oblivious, sold on his own goodness. In addition to this very The Office-like sitcom, it features a cast of annoying eccentrics. There are interviews with real celebrities who appear as their non-animated 3D selves. In the clip, we're going to hear Zach Woods as the radio host, Lauren Caspian. You'll also hear Caitlin Riley as Fabian, one of the show's producers. Jay Smith Cameron as Barb, the executive producer of the show. And let's have a listen.
Great interview, Lauren.
No, it's a team effort. I'm merely the big daddy.
Oh, I also wanted to let everyone know that that homeless gentleman is still in the bathroom.
Barb.
Huh?
That is hate speech. He is an unhoused person.
Actually, the preferred term is person who is currently without housing.
No, I don't think so. Are you sure?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm really very empathetic to the man's situation. I volunteer at a homeless shelter.
But no, you volunteer at an unhoused shelter.
A shelter for persons currently without housing.
Well, it just feels very clunky.
Oh, I'm sorry. Is it too inconvenient to treat vulnerable populations with respect?
How dare you? I was using the term Inuit back in the 90s. I've been spelling women with a Y since before I could spell my name.
Oh, my God. It's so bad. Can I say that? I just can't even hold it.
You don't even need a question. You're ready to go. Let's hear it.
Like, let's stop. Like, you really think making jokes about white liberals' angst over what to call homeless people, you think that's new?
Right.
You think that's fun? He's just like, he consistently acts like grabbing the lowest hanging fruit. He acts like that's a 5-course meal. It ain't. Like, so much of the humor in this show is entirely predictable. entirely predictable. And it just felt stale and flat to me. I also think that, like, I was gaming this out. I was like, all right, let's say this scenario actually happened in an NPR office. And I can speak to this because I worked at NPR for 13 years, and I was an NPR host myself for 5 or 6 of them. Let me tell you something about NPR. It is a company that has facilities and operations management. And there are adults watching the store who would say, we can't have an unhoused man in this bathroom all day. And so to see him let this scene play out like that and so many other scenes play out like that, it felt very much like that episode of Euphoria where all the teenagers get in a fight at the school play and the fight keeps going on and never stops. And you're like, where are the administrators? Where is the vice principal? Where is the principal? They do exist. It's the same thing happening with this show. Like, you have all these dumb liberals and no one's keeping the store. There's always someone keeping the store at NPR because it's a company that must make money. And so that was my first big quip with it.
So, Nadira, like, point taken, this probably doesn't represent what the interior of, you know, NPR offices in D.C. or the various regional outposts around the country are like. One could still make a funny show that's fanciful about that. Did they do that?
I don't know. I guess. I don't have the experience of working for public radio or working at NPR, but I do love a workplace satire and a workplace comedy, and I didn't necessarily hate or love this show at most points. I think because
ringing
of what...
endorsement.
I think because of what Sam was talking about earlier, because it is sort of predictable in many ways, I mostly found it to be boring. Again, these are not caricatures that I haven't heard before. I'm a millennial myself. The character of Fabian I found to be quite annoying, but also I get it. You know, this is how people want to make fun of us. It's fine. It's nothing I haven't heard before. And that's kind of how I felt about most of the show. But with that being said, I do think it has its funny moments. You know, if someone told me that I looked like an undercover cop at an Avril Lavigne concert, I would cry. And I think the joke about J-Lo potentially being a victim of wage theft is actually really funny, given those rumors or accusations that she notoriously has stopped people she dines with from tipping servers. So, you know, it has its funny moments. But I really want to talk about the sort of the style differentiations in the show. So the actual show is stop motion with puppets, and I love stop motion. I think stop motion is so evocative in really specific and obviously handcrafted ways. But then when Lauren interviews people on the show, these are real celebrities who are just in their regular digital form as if they were on a video chat. And it's really clear that they are improv-ing with these celebrities, and the names that they get for this show run the gamut from Kaya Gerber and Tegan and Sarah to Mike Tyson extolling the facets of violence as a state of mind, and Ken Burns and Hugh Laurie. And I actually
and
really
Jonathan
like...
And Jonathan Van Ness, yes, who I think was my favorite part of the show. He's so good.
And you know, J-Lo just said...
Who's that?
Jennifer Lopez, obviously.
I'm not familiar. Is she a victim of wage theft?
Oh, honey.
I really actually liked those interviews, but I think that's kind of as far as I got. The stop motion was cool. The knitwear that the puppets were wearing was really cool. Whoever took their little fingers and made all those tiny sweaters did a great job. And I really liked the celebrities.
So I'm curious to hear you guys speak to this. So Slate's podcasting division was more or less started by an NPR veteran. Most of our producers have worked for NPR, shuffle back and forth between us and them. The shows, panelists have gone on NPR shows, various places. Became familiar with an institution I only knew as a listener during most of my life because of the show. To me, what I love about it is my wife is from the deep South, right? And she grew up very much in but not of it. And so for her, NPR was this oasis of, you know, contemplative, thoughtful, totally non-sensationalistic journalism. You know, when we used to go visit our grandparents down in Alabama, just the fact that all you needed to do was shove the radio dial in the car all the way to the left, search about for 3 minutes, and you were going to land on some little college radio station that is an NPR affiliate, and that, there was something enormously reassuring about its ubiquity through every part of the American continent, no matter where you are. To me, it's an amazing American institution. And it has foibles, but it's a very gentle bad guy if you're searching for bad guys. Why treat it with this level of contempt? Because for me, the dominant note of this show is that it seems to genuinely hate this lead character, right? Like, this figure is utterly hateful to the people who created this television show. There's nothing redeemable or interesting or good or even intelligent about him. He's just a pretentious dweeb. And, you know, some of that shit lands on me, right? So of course the show makes me angry in response. But am I misreading it? Am I just taking it personally in this weird, I mean, they don't have me in mind. Don't get me wrong. I'm not deluded, but am I wrong? It's like, it's mean-spirited.
I think that, like, it's possible to respect a place like NPR and also mock it mercilessly because, right, you know, companies aren't people. Companies are made of people. I think watching this horrible host, I did feel like some of it was like speaking right to me, a former NPR host. It's like, oh shit, am I a man who talks over women in interviews? Oh shit, am I a man who in interviews tries to virtue signal through my interview questions, right? Like all these things, it's like good questions to ask. But I think what the creators of this show were doing when they mock this NPR host so mercilessly, they're also mocking NPR listeners. They're also mocking the people who listen to these folks all the time and prop them up. The reason Lauren the host is such a dick and feels so entitled to be a dick is because there's probably thousands of listeners who tell him every day that he's great. That he's great, right?
Right.
I'm actually friends with a few of the people who consulted on this show from NPR. And my good friend Elise Hugh, who's talked about this with Vulture, she was like, yeah, this show is critiquing the NPR audience as much as it is NPR listeners. And as someone who got NPR letters from NPR listeners for years, you think NPR hosts are bad. Some of these listeners, I mean, truly pieces of work. And I'm all about content that is hopefully asking those folks to be introspective. I think my largest issue, though, with this show is that, like, by parodying extreme liberal woke whiteness, it's still centering whiteness. And NPR, quiet as it's kept, is not quite as white as this show wants you to believe. And I would love to have seen more of the interplay of an organization and people grappling with how a very white organization becomes less white. That, as a workplace drama or workplace comedy, would have interested me. But you don't get that in the workplace comedy parts of the show. You just don't get it.
Yeah, I also just want to push back on, I don't know. Okay, here's my history with NPR, you guys. So when I was a kid, I wanted to listen to nothing but the Disney Channel radio station. And my grandmother once told me in her Subaru Outback that her radio was broken and only played NPR. And so for the longest
time,
and I believed her. And so for the longest time, I sort of, that was hanging over the head of my relationship with NPR, I guess. But I came to love it and enjoy it in my adult years, my more formative years. And with that, I want to sort of push back on the idea that public radio or NPR specifically isn't sensational. I feel like there's one part of the show that I actually really identified with, which is, and I don't necessarily remember who Lauren is interviewing at the time, but there's this notion that Lauren presents a safe space, but is actually mining for dirt to exploit the guests, right? So they put on their NPR voice and they're like, now tell me about the most traumatic point in your life. Or tell me about, you know, like your parents' drama or whatever.
Well,
tell
this
me
is
about
the thing. It's like you could,
10 years ago.
You can have sensational content without people yelling.
Exactly.
And let me tell you something. In my many years as an NPR host, I got to be really good at using the whisper talk voice to throw a motherfucking punch.
Yep.
You know?
Yeah.
So I would have loved for that to be more explored, right? I guess what we're both saying is, like, the most interesting places to really dig deep in a contemplative, you know, discussion of NPR and what it means, he didn't go there. He didn't go there.
Right.
It was just low-hanging fruit.
I second that, Sam. And also, I have to say, I didn't find it very funny. There were some chuckles, some yucks. I thought some of the celebrity interview questions were so hilariously, mind-bendingly absurd.
Yeah.
That was kind of
fun.
And watching them respond to that on the fly was pretty good. Anyway, The show is In the Know. It's on Peacock. Check it out and let us know what you think. All right, let's move on. Our podcast is brought to you by Progressive Insurance. Most of you listening right now are probably multitasking. You're listening. Okay, we appreciate that. You're also probably driving, cleaning, exercising, maybe grocery shopping. But if you're not in some kind of a moving vehicle, there's something else you can be doing right now. Getting an auto quote from Progressive Insurance. It's easy and you could save money by doing it right from your phone. Drivers who save by switching to Progressive save nearly $750 on average, and auto customers qualify for an average of 7 discounts. Discounts for having multiple vehicles on your policy, being a homeowner, and more. Just like us, Progressive is there for you 24/7, 365 days a year. You're protected no matter what. Multitask right now. Quote your car insurance at progressive.com to join the over 28 million drivers who trust Progressive. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and affiliates. National average 12-month savings of $744 by new customers surveyed who saved with Progressive between June 2022 and May 2023. Potential savings will vary. Discounts not available in all states and situations.
Reboot your credit card with Apple Card. It gives you unlimited daily cash back that can automatically grow over time when you open a savings account. A high-yield, low-effort way to grow your money with no fees. Apply for Apple Card in the Wallet app on iPhone to start earning daily cash and growing it with savings today. Apple Card subject to credit approval. Savings available to Apple Card owners subject to eligibility. Apple Card and savings by Goldman Sachs Bank USA, Salt Lake City Branch. Member FDIC. Terms apply.
Well, I mean, what do the Oscars exist for, Nadira, if not to talk about the Oscars? Actually, watching it's a bit of a bore, and who wins turns out to be, in retrospect, largely irrelevant, sometimes hilariously so. And yet, to chew over it, overthink it, go meta upon meta, here we are, right? And this year, it handed us the juiciest piece of red meat in not nominating Greta Gerwig for Best Director for Barbie, even though Barbie's nominated for Best Picture and is the highest grossing film of the year, and the Oscars have paid more attention to commercial outcomes I would argue, over the last roughly decade, and no nomination for Best Actress for Margot Robbie. Now, every year there are going to be snubs. There's garden variety snubs. There's Leonardo DiCaprio not getting nominated for Best Actor for Killers of the Flower Moon. But these aren't garden variety, I think, for a fairly obvious reason. This is a feminist picture that cleaned up at the box office and got some rave reviews. What's going on here?
Gosh. I'm sort of afraid to say what I actually think is going on here.
Well, then, say it.
Which is basically just white feminism. I don't know. Can you necessarily call it a snub if both Greta Gerwig and Margot Robbie are nominated for Oscars? I don't know if you can call it an Oscar snub if
they're
nominated.
Picture, yeah.
I mean, Gerwig is also nominated for adapted screenplay. And yeah, Robbie is nominated for a producer in, you know, by form of Best Picture. And the movie made $1 billion. It is the only woman-directed picture to ever do so. It is inherently a commercial. I think all things considered, the movie is fine. They are fine. They are rolling in their money. They're doing okay. The reason this discourse startles me is because, besides the fact that it got so widespread that Hillary Clinton is making public statements about the valiant achievements of these women in Hollywood. Like, girl.
Like, Hillary, why are you in it?
Why are you in it? It's just, no one is sort of doing the math to figure that if these women were to get nominated in these categories, then other women in these categories would have to go, or other people would have to go. And I, you know, what do we say to Justine Triet, who directed Anatomy of a Fall? Or what do we say to the other women who also gave amazing performances that were nominated for Best Actress? You know, I...
What do you say to America Ferrera, a woman who did get a nomination out of this movie?
Listen, okay, I wrote an entire piece about how much I love America Ferrera and how much I love to see her get nominated for this award, even though I don't think her performance and technically the script actually makes her worthy of it. But yeah, it's sort of ironic to see these calls of, you know, we've got to protect feminism and this is a front against feminism from people who frankly just haven't mentioned calls for feminism in other areas where it is sort of gravely needed right now. But I do think the uproar about this quote unquote snub, which I don't actually think is a snub, is actually sort of very telling about the way feminism in a mainstream sense continues to operate, well, I guess just in the mainstream, but particularly in America. And so I think it's a really interesting sort of experiment to just watch play out in real time. But it definitely had me scratching my head.
Points taken. One thing we should point out, though, is that you know, they expanded one category to 10 nominees. And Barbie, you sort of feel as though slipped in the bottom five of the 10 nominees for Best Picture in some sense. And so you can understand why that might not quite compensate for no director nomination. But then, as you guys point out, well, go over the five Best Actress nominees. Who are you bumping in that list, right? Go over the five Best Director nominees. Who are you bumping in that list in order to slot in Gerwig and Robbie, respectively? I mean, extra inflammatory is that there's a Best Actor nomination for Ryan Gosling, the man in the film. Merited, unmerited, scandalous, or he was just maybe, like, that good in the movie?
Merited.
Yeah, merited. I mean, this is my thing with the snub of Margot Robbie. When you watch that movie, who actually has the most meat in the film? Who gets the song? Who gets the choreo? Who says more words? Who does more things? Ken. And, like, Greta wrote that, right? So Greta wrote a fuller character for Ken than she wrote for Barbie. And it perfectly makes sense that Ken gets a nomination given what happens in that movie. It's really hard for the Academy to honor the kind of work that Margot Robbie did for Barbie. You know, she's asked to play this role that is flat and stiff because it's a doll, and no actress nomination at the Oscars does acknowledge the production work that Margot Robbie did to get this film made. You'll recall when Mattel wanted to make Barbie, they went to Margot first, and then Margot found Greta, and then Margot said, Greta, let's do this. So I wish there were a hybrid actress-producer Oscar that she could be nominated for, because that's what she's doing. But yeah, if it's just me watching the movie and saying who has the better performance, it's Ken/Ryan Gosling because he has more to work with. And I cannot blame the patriarchy for that because Greta Gerwig wrote the movie.
I 100% agree with everything you just said, Sam. And I think I just feel as though our time would be better spent talking about other actors or creators who were actually snubbed. When I think about Charles Melton and I think about the sort of fiery run.
All of May, December. There should have been three acting nominations for May December.
Yes, 100%
agree.
Yeah, I totally
agree.
May December was great. Charles Melton as a Riverdale alumnus was amazing.
Julianne Moore's lisp.
Yeah.
It's so good.
Alone.
The cast of Past Lives, also, you know, no nomination. And when I think about the movie 1001, the Tiana Taylor-led movie, which was one of my favorite movies of last year, and I think did top a fair number of top 10 lists from critics. And I think about how silent the discussion about that movie has been come award season. I get actively angry. Tiana Taylor is someone who has been fighting against the industry her entire career, whether it be in her music career or her acting career or what have you. And she finally gets this phenomenal breakout role with Josiah Cross playing opposite her. And she's so good. She is so good in this movie that is well written, that is well shot and well directed, that is beautiful and heartbreaking. And no one makes a sound about it, even though it's a depiction of a Black woman who's a single mother who, you know, is trying to provide for her son. It's all of the things that we sort of claim that we're hailing when we're talking about feminism and we're talking about intersectional feminism. And there are crickets. There's no one talking about it. But instead, we are again talking about a movie that made $1 billion. Why?
Yeah.
Why?
Well, And when you look at the kind of conversation about feminism that Barbie is having, and it is a movie about feminism, it is feminism 101.
Right.
It is things are hard for women compared to men. And it does not at all ever get into any kind of intersectionality. You know, there is a trans Barbie in that movie. They don't address transness. You know, there is Black President Issa Rae Barbie who never addresses racism. There is a character who feels like he's gay, but we never say he's gay. And then Kate McKinnon is clearly a lesbian Barbie, and we don't say it. And also, Margot and Greta don't need to be saved. That's what I don't like about this conversation. People
exactly.
taking up arms to defend these really wealthy women who are never going to suffer for work ever
the
again in their
made
careers.
$1 billion. I think they're cool.
It made $1 billion.
It made over $1 billion. I think they are fine.
Can I just push back a tiny bit on that?
Yes, because please do. Please do.
I get it. You got to size the violin to the pity party, you know? And
yeah.
And I don't disagree that, you know, people who are, you know, as you say, swimming in accolades, money, and status from this movie, you can still be a little stung. And it may even be somewhat, in some respects, meaningful that the community in which you make your projects, you know, pointedly fails to honor the work you've done. It's hard not to find a significance in it that's apart from, you know, all the other success you might have had from the project. But point taken, we, you know, the world's smallest violin here.
Here's the thing. I actually think that snubs are worth talking about. Perhaps it's just my broken media culture brain that loves talking about them. I just don't necessarily agree that this is a snub. But when I think about Adele winning her Grammy for Album of the Year, standing in front of Beyoncé and saying that Beyoncé deserved it, and then Beyoncé losing again to Taylor Swift.
To Harry Styles.
Oh, right. It was Harry Styles. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Harry Styles, who I love, but stood on stage and said, "This never happens to people like me." Again, I get angry. I get genuinely upset. It feels like you can be, again, like you were saying, Steve, it feels like you can have all of the money and you can reach mass audiences, but it does hurt to not be recognized by your peers or to actually be recognized by your peers who stand on stage and say that you deserve the award they are currently holding, but to not be recognized by the people who actually make those decisions about who gets the award.
Yeah. And like when I think of snubs at award shows like the Oscars, I think like, what are the Oscars really for and who do they help the most? An Oscar for Greta Gerwig is much less helpful to Greta Gerwig than an Oscar for someone no one knew about before. And so with these nominations, I'm most excited about the ones who kind of came out of nowhere. I'm excited that now Cord Jefferson is going to be getting great work for years because of American Fiction and its nominations. It might not win any Oscars. But, like, the nomination opens a door. And so when I think of snubs, I want to think about that, and I want to think about how the Oscars and other award shows are actually functioning best when they open doors for folks we've never heard of, not when they give more flowers to the richest, most successful woman director of all time. Of all time.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we'll leave it there. I'm sure there's going to be a lot of opinions and back and forth on this one. Let us know what you think. Let's move on. This episode is brought to you by SAP. First, the bad news. SAP Business AI won't help you generate cubist versions of your family's holiday photos, but it will help you understand which supplier is best to help you roll out your plant-based packaging in Southeast Asia. Identify the training your junior project manager needs to rise up the ranks, and automate repetitive tasks while you focus on big innovations so you can be ready for the next opportunity. Revolutionary technology, real-world results, that's SAP Business AI. This show is sponsored by BetterHelp. Common misperception about relationships is that they have to be easy to be right, but sometimes the best ones happen when both people put in the work to make them great. Therapy can be a place to work through the challenges you face in all your relationships, whether with friends, work, your significant other, or anyone. And here I can offer a personal note. Hear, therapy, I believe in it. And it's exactly that. It's a safe place under controlled conditions so as to make the rest of the relationships in your life that much less challenging and that much more meaningful. So if you're thinking of starting therapy, give BetterHelp a try. It's entirely online, designed to be convenient, flexible, suited to your schedule. Just fill out a brief questionnaire to get matched with a licensed therapist and switch therapists anytime with no additional charge. Become your own soulmate, whether you're looking for one or not. Visit betterhelp.com/culture today to get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/culture. All right, now is the moment in our podcast when we endorse. Sam, let's start with you. What did you bring us this week?
I'm bringing an old album that I have been loving for a few months now, and it's all I tell my friends about when they ask what I'm listening to. I actually have it on vinyl right here to show you guys. It is an album by the R&B group LaBelle called Chameleon. LaBelle is Patti LaBelle's singing group that she had before she went solo. It's her and two other women, and they can sing. This is the cover art for Chameleon. Isn't it beautiful?
Yes. Yes.
Isn't it beautiful? That's the front. This is the back. And what I'm showing these other folks here on the mic with me is this album cover that has Patti and her co-stars in the most beautiful Afrofuturist getup with their mouths open, teeth smiling. And it sets you up for an album that is just full of R&B, funk, dazzle. They are singing top to bottom, every track. And what I love about this album is that all of them can sing. Something happened around the 80s or 90s, you know, R&B groups, boy groups, girl groups, they started to have like one person who could really sing and the rest of them kind of couldn't. Everyone in LaBelle can sing. This album, Chameleon, I put it on vinyl in the morning as I'm making my coffee, as I'm starting my day, and it just gives me this bolt of energy. If you want to pick me up, if you want an album to work out to, if you just want to hear some good singing, this old LaBelle album called Chameleon is delightful. And going back through that history of Patti at that time, it really makes you respect her more as kind of the mother of Afrofuturism in pop. And we see that legacy directly in everything Beyoncé has done visually around Renaissance. It is wonderful to see that through line, and it's always a good moment to listen to Patti LaBelle sing, because
yes,
come on.
Yes.
So yeah, LaBelle, Chameleon.
Nadira, what do you have for us?
So not to be one note, but my endorsement is quite similar.
Okay.
Okay, first of all, one thing I want to say about Miss Patti is that I'm from Philly.
Miss Patti.
She from Philly.
Okay.
And,
okay,
you know, we love ourselves a Philly girl. And so
yes,
speaking of Philly groups, Silk, the soul funk group from Philadelphia that released the album Midnight Dancer,
wow,
in 1979.
Wait, Silk of Meeting in My Bedroom fame?
No, no. Okay.
Not them.
So
there was
not,
another Silk.
Right, so not to be confused with the 1990s R&B male group from Atlanta, Georgia of the same name, whose most popular song is Freak Me, not that group. Same subtext of their music, different groups. So we're talking,
okay,
the soul funk group in the Philly soul era that released the album Midnight Dancer in 1979. I love that album. I find it often overlooked in the general discussion of 70s, 80s soul funk. And being from Philly, I'm trying to learn more about the more unsung artists of the Philly soul era. So being a fan of Midnight Dancer, the album, I plugged that into the Spotify function where you can create a radio station based on a song or artist.
Mm-hmm.
And I got a ton of great music suggestions that I had never heard before, or some that I had heard before but had forgotten about, including a beautiful song called Silly Wasn't I by Valerie Simpson, as in half of Ashford and Simpson, music by Odyssey, both Odyssey bands, because apparently there were two bands called Odyssey and I always thought that they were one band, but that's for a different podcast. Songs from Lattimore's 1976 album, album, It Ain't Where You've Been, Sonia Spence's song, Let the Love Flow On, which also led me to look a little bit more into Sonia Spence, who was a Jamaican singer, and I'm half Jamaican, and so I did not know this, and she actually has some beautiful reggae songs from back in the day that are really worth listening to, hit songs from the British group Loose Ends, and hits from Barbara Acklin. And I want to shout out Barbara Acklin, the soul singer who was most popular during the 60s and 70s. It seems like the only thing on Spotify that you can have from her or hear from her is a compilation of her 20 greatest hits, but they are truly so great, all 20. And I specifically love her song, Am I the Same Girl, which will be very familiar. Once you put it on, you'll hear it and you'll be like, oh yeah, I know this song. So I guess this is an endorsement for the soul funk group Silk, the playlist radio creating functions on music streaming platforms, and Barbara Acklin, all three rolled into one.
I love that you bring this up because I was just telling a friend last week, quiet as it's kept, the Spotify algorithm has gotten really good.
It's gotten so
good. It's good. And I hate to admit it because I believe in real people picking out real music for other real people, but damn, that algo works.
Yeah, so definitely
it works.
Whatever your favorite album or song is or just something that's stuck in your head this week, just try the create radio function.
Create radio station, yeah.
And just see what pops up. I'm sure you'll get some great finds that you've never heard before.
Okay, well, going in a totally opposite direction, I am a sucker for kind of bewitching, half-forgotten home recordings by doomed folkies. And so, or they don't have to be home recordings necessarily, so like Jackson C. Frank or, you know, or the home recordings of Nick Drake, which are freaking amazing. And I'm shocked to discover one that I was totally unfamiliar with, Sandy Denny, who was the lead singer for Fairport Convention and has one of the most exquisitely beautiful singing voices I think I've ever heard, and wrote one of the most enduring, like, and exquisitely beautiful classics in the folk canon. Who knows where the time goes? I mean, you know, just covered endlessly and beautifully by various artists. There are just a bunch of old home recordings of her. I think she's famously sort of performance phobic, or she was doomed in ways that I'm afraid I don't know the exact specifics of, but she was just a beautiful guitarist and singer and songwriter, and they're wonderful. I mean, they're just lo-fi, gorgeous, and really haunting. Who knows what the time? So they're the early home recordings. It's by Sandy Denny, D-E-N-N-Y. We will post a link to it. Sam, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Oh my God, this was delightful. I feel like I, in some moments, had some, like, get off my lawn energy, but y'all were so nice and accommodating and excuse my rants. Thank y'all. This was delightful.
You're hardly the first to bring that energy to this hour of programming, Sam. And Nadira, as always, what an enormous pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks for having me, as always.
You will find links to some of the things we talked about today at our show page. That's slate.com/culturefest. And you can email us at culturefest@slate.com. Our introductory theme music is by the composer Nicholas Patel. Our production assistant is Kat Hong. Our producer is Cameron Drews. For Sam Sanders and Adira Goff, I'm Stephen Metcalf. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you soon.